Good morning, everyone. Let's start off worship with the song, Shall We Gather at the River? I was just kind of running out of space on this sheet. For those who maybe didn't get a printed copy, it is on Facebook and in an email. But just note where that refrain is in case you need to go up to it to find that later. Shall we gather at the river? Just helping us picture what heaven might look like, what a glorious kingdom would look like. And so if you'd just please join me in singing, Shall We Gather at the River?
Well, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's join together in prayer. Almighty God, you knit your people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know that inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, good morning. Great to gather together. This is All Saints Day. Just a question. Anybody here feeling a little strange, like their body doesn't know what time it is? Honk your horn. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Exactly. So today we're going to think about time and what it means to be God's people here in this time and space. Just a couple announcements to share. The first is next week we're going to be moving our drive-in worship service back to the parking lot at Grace, and we're going to be grateful to be there. Hopefully we'll have a little bit more protection from the wind as we gather there. Also, just want to let you know that next week we will be having a blessing for the animals. So if you want to have an animal of yours with you in your vehicle, we encourage you to bring that animal. The blessing will be something where we pray in thanksgiving for these wonderful companions that we have. We'll ask you to lay a hand on your animal or a toy or a picture of your animal that will help you remember this gift that we have from God. And so that'll be next Sunday during our worship service. Also want to let you know that Carol Kress has snowmen, and she's in a red Chevy in the front row, and she will be glad to share information about our snowmen for the homeless project. It's a fundraiser for our mission team, and Carol will be glad to share more with you about that. Also want to let you know that Saturday night we are going to have a drive-in movie at Grace. It's hosted by Merge, a combination of youth groups in our community, and it will be on Saturday night at Grace. Not sure of too many other announcements to share at this time. I get to invite Laura to come forward and share the readings with us today.
The first reading is from the book of Revelation, the 7th chapter. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." And then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorched heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Here ends the first reading. Our psalm today is Psalm 34. It's printed on your handout. I invite you to join me in reading the bold parts. I'll read along with you. "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord, and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and deliver them. O, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. O, fear the Lord, you his holy ones, For those who fear him have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. And a reading from 1 John, the third chapter. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Here ends the reading.
If you would please join me in singing, I Will Rise. And just a quick note that there's one more little piece to the song on the flip side. And I like towards the end, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. If you would please join me in singing.
Thank you.
So reading from the Gospel of Matthew, we say, glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and then he began to speak, and he taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil falsely against you on my account. Rejoice, be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the gospel of the Lord, and we say praise to you, O Christ. O grace, peace, friends, from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is, was, and will be the Christ. Amen. So the psalm we shared today is a prayer of gratitude and hope. It's a prayer that starts with a call to praise God at all times, in the good times, in the tough times. And this has got me thinking about time, what time it is and what it means to trust God and pray to God at all times. See, if I only think about here and right now, what's going on this earth, that's one way to look at time. But today, after daylight savings has ended, my body, it just feels off. My brain, my body, they say, you know, it's 11 o'clock. The watch on my wrist, that's been automatically updated. It says it's 10 o'clock. But my body, it just isn't there. There's something in me that says, you know what, time isn't what it says. I wonder if anybody else just feels that little bit off today. See, a good friend of mine, he doesn't like daylight savings time at all. He thinks we should just stick to one time schedule period. That's it. He said that if any candidate for office will announce that that is part of his platform, he has their full support. It's all the politics I'm going to share today, okay? Don't get too nervous. See, I want to think today about time, not just daylight savings time, but time. This year has been knocked off. It feels so out of line. The rhythms that we know, all the things that we count on in this year have been just a little bit off, a little unsettled. And when times seem different and things seem unsettled, this is when I hear the words that we shared in this psalm. This psalm is a testimony to faith, to bless the Lord at all times, to let his praise be in our mouths. It's a word of hope in the good times and in the bad times. See, this is what real faith is about. It's about knowing deep in your bones that God is still active, even when the evidence in the world around you is totally the opposite. Even when you're in trouble, even when you need help, this is when the psalm says we should pray. Pray in praise and thanksgiving for God at all time. See, we talk about time like it's valuable, like it's useful. We use our time for work. We share our time with our friends and our family, and we waste time. And this psalm asks us as God's people to call out in praise to God at all times. So what time is it? Psalm writer would say, now is the time to pray. People might look at their clock or their watch. Some people might say, well, it's Sunday morning. It's time for us to gather to be church. People might point to the calendar and they might say, well, it's the first weekend in November. And as church, we say this is the week to remember all the saints, all those people who are part of the kingdom of God, both those in heaven and on earth. What time is it? So many great jokes have been told about people when they arrive in heaven. One of my favorites is about a preacher who arrived in heaven, and when he got into heaven, he was given a cotton robe and a walking stick. And he just said, oh, that must be what everybody gets when they get here. Then the angels rushed past him to the pearly gates to meet another man who was coming in. They rushed in with silk robes. They rushed in with the finest shoes. They rushed in and they offered him a golden crown. They brought him to a beautiful horse-drawn carriage to ride in. Preacher looked at the angels and said to one, who is that? What's so special about him? I was a preacher for 45 years. I think I did a pretty good job. Think of all the time I shared with those people in those churches. Angel shook his head and replied, you know, that man was a cab driver in Manhattan, in New York City. When he drove, people prayed. When you preached, people just fell asleep. It's an oldie but a goodie, folks. I just think of this time. What do we make of time? What do we do with time? How do we use our time? What time is it? We might be asking ourselves today. See, this psalm writer says we can praise God at all times. This psalm speaks to our soul, saying we can praise God in the good days and in the tough days. We can remember what God has done and look ahead to the day when we see our family in Christ that is so much bigger than what we can see today. Look ahead, the psalm writer would say. Look ahead, say this to your soul today. Look ahead and remember who you are. Let this psalm be a testimony. Let it help you remember what it is to live in faith. The writer of Hebrews gave us this beautiful definition of faith. Faith is being sure of what we hope for, certain of what we do not see. This is what it is to believe. This is what it is to live today as part of the body of Christ. Praise God in all days, good and bad. This is a promise for your soul and for mine. Because God's promise, it's not far away. God's reign is not far from us at all. God is building a kingdom. Think, God has a plan to bring you, me, all of us into his kingdom. See, oftentimes we talk about God's kingdom like it's the goal, like it's the final place we are trying to reach. And yes, there is a promise in Jesus of a great reward in heaven for his people. But Jesus shared a vision of his kingdom on a mountaintop that was so close that his friends could reach and touch it. Jesus invited his friends to envision themselves in the kingdom of God, yes, at the end of time, but also now. Here, in this world, with the challenges, with the divisions that are here. These words that Matthew recorded are often called the Beatitudes. Jesus spoke them as he looked to the crowds that came for healing and to hear him teach with power. So he sat down on a mountaintop in Galilee, and his disciples, they gathered close to him. And that's when he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn. They will be comforted. See, Jesus has a kingdom, and you are invited to call that kingdom home today. His kingdom bigger than earth and sky. It's a kingdom we can live in starting here and now, and that we will live in for all time. See, not everyone, though, believes there is a kingdom. Not everyone wants Jesus' kingdom to come. But Jesus' promise is sure. He has a kingdom, and it is coming into being. It's a kingdom where power and injustice are flipped over. It's a place where those who are pushed around and pushed down will be lifted up. He meant it when he said, blessed are the meek, they will inherit the earth. Blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness, you will be filled. As God's people, this promise of the kingdom has given the church hope for generations. Think of it. It was hope when the Roman Empire wanted to stamp Christianity out at the start. It was hope in the middle of this nation's civil war that we call this nation home. We can't even imagine how divided this place was. This kingdom promise helps us see a way to come through the worst of this world. It helps us to live in this world knowing it isn't perfect, knowing what is broken. Now, some people say we shouldn't waste our time on anybody but ourselves. But Jesus gives us this kingdom vision, this hope, because it helps us see our way through the challenges. Jesus says, value yourselves as much as you value others. Jesus spoke of mercy, pure hearts, peacemaking, and righteousness as the greatest, most valuable things we could have in this world. His kingdom, it's defined by people who live today like mercy and justice, peace, are what matter most of all. Jesus has a plan for you, for me. He has a way. And he called his people blessed. Blessed. Way past today, you will be blessed. Blessed way past this earth, you will be blessed. Blessed when everything isn't perfect. Blessed because this is who God is. This is what God is up to. See, to follow Jesus is to see the world as it is, and also to see the promise of the kingdom that he is building. So part of our why we're a church, is remembering this promise that Jesus has a way, that Jesus has a plan, that Jesus has a kingdom. Especially when times are challenging, we need this promise. We need it because it gives us hope that this world could never give. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Jesus says, rejoice, be glad. Yours is the kingdom of God. So remember those words from the mountaintop today. Remember, this is the way that Jesus talks to his people. Blessed are. As a kid, my dad called the Sermon on the Mount the thou shalts of being a Christian. He said, if the Ten Commandments are the things we're not supposed to do, this is Jesus' direction. This is him saying, come on, people of God. This is the way I want you to move into this world. Come on, people of God. These are words that shape our identity. In Christ, you are free to come broken, needing to be made whole. In Christ, you are free to come with grief, needing comfort. In Christ, you are free to come empty, knowing that Jesus can give us what we really hunger for. See, this world has given us so much, but the promise of God's kingdom is even more. Remember, you are God's people. And as God's people, you are invited to live with kingdom values right now in this world. Today, we can live like mercy and kindness and peace matter most of all. I've heard people talk about heaven, like God's people will be part of a great choir. I've heard other people talk about heaven like it's going to be a great banquet. But over the years, I get a feeling that being in God's presence will be a lot like a reunion and a potluck all at once. Think of the family who waits for us in the kingdom of heaven, a family from many nations, a family from many generations. I keep imagining this reunion, this potluck. Imagine all the different food that the family of God brings from all kinds of nations of the world. Imagine all the stories that will be told. Imagine all the hugs that will be shared as people are welcomed into God's presence. See, this is All Saints Day after all. This great day to remember who we are and who God's people are and will be. So we don't always talk about the kingdom of God. We don't always see our place in it. But right now, in the middle of challenging times, it seems like we should. See, it's so easy when the challenges are real to focus just on this world, what's right in front of my nose, what I'm worried about right now. But Jesus would say to us, people of God, you are part of a family that is bigger than today. You are part of a body, and that means you have a connection with everyone and anyone who has ever walked with Jesus, who walks today with him, and who will walk with him in days to come. This is bigger than you. This is bigger than me. This is bigger than our time. Bigger than one nation, bigger than one race. This is a promise for all of us. So on All Saints Day, we look back with gratitude, thankful for God's steadfast love, blessed by people past and present who have shared God's love with us, offering thanks for all the gifts that God has given us. On our little table here, we put out Some votive candles. I didn't even try to light them, folks. But I put them out, and they're a reminder, because we lit them inside the building at Grace, they're a reminder that our relationship with God starts not in our death, but in our baptism. They're a reminder, a living reminder, that God is up to something with us and for us. So we gather today, like that psalmist said, to praise God in all times, to praise God in all places. We gather in hope, hope built on the promise that Jesus shall reign. We gather in hope around a cross, trusting that the God of Easter morning has a plan to bring us all to life, even after death. We gather in hope that he will rule and reign in our lives. And for that we say amen. And glory be to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
If you would please join me now in singing When the Saints Go Marching In, and clapping and marching around, or just stomping in your car, that's all appropriate. We're celebrating the saints today, and this is a really fun song to do that with. So When the Saints Go Marching In.
Saints go marching.
Join together in the creed. As we declare our faith today, we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. At this time, we take a few minutes for an observation of all the saints who have been part of our life at Grace. There are roses, and the wind is probably too strong to set them up on this table, so they're in the back of Todd's van. And you are invited at the end of the service to, I'll probably take those roses with me and try and pass them to families. If you have lost someone in this past year, this is our chance to remember. See, death affects the world around us in many ways. And we celebrate All Saints Day, lifting up the memories of the blessed saints we have known. And we do so with mixed feelings of love and grief. And we continue today our worship and prayer and remembrance, thankful to God for having given us special people to know and to love. So we have these roses that we set on our altar inside, and today we have with us here as a memory of each person from our community of faith who died since last year's All Saints Remembrance, for those who receive pastoral care from Grace. And we invite, I don't know if you want to really stand outside today, but we'd invite you to turn on your lights, to somehow remember those folks today as their names are read. Before we do that, we join in the first verse of Jesus Loves Me. Joyce Stussy, Bob Sexy, Jan Simon, Janice Nelson, Judy Kutnick, Tom O'Sell, Art Busing, Arvid Bindi, Roger Hall, Lorianne Underdahl, Diane Olson, Tom Allsworth, Ruth Nafis, Donna Torgerson, Bill Christensen, Steve Jensen, Curtis Jones, Arlene Brolsma, Dorothy Dunker, we join together in the second verse of Jesus Loves Me.
Time.
Death has had a significant impact on our life as a church together. Death has also touched our lives beyond our relationships here at Grace. In some celebrations of All Saints, the congregation are given the opportunity to light a candle and place it on the altar in memory of the life and death of someone close to them. This year at Grace, we place out 14 votive candles in honor of the 14 who have been baptized this year. To help us remember that we enter into God's kingdom, into God's family, not at the time of our death, but when we are called into a relationship in the waters of baptism with our risen and reigning Lord. So at this time, instead of lighting a candle, you are invited to flash your lights, to stand up if you have lost someone close to you this past year. We join together in the last verse of Jesus Loves Me. St. Paul reminds us, we are the body of Christ, and when one member suffers, we all suffer together. So we rise today in support of our fellow members of the body of Christ, and we join together in prayer. Called to be God's people, we pray for the church, the world, and all people according to their needs. Lord God, we give you thanks for the church that you have called us together to be your people, that you have gathered us with many stories to share. Give us hope and give us courage to be your church, to help build your kingdom here and now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we give you thanks for the gifts of all creation, for the work you give us to do, for the family and friends who you bless us with. Help us, God, to work with persistence and perseverance that we might share your love with all people in this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us, God, as we pray for our nation and for all nations of the world. Give us wisdom as individuals coming to this season of election. Give us courage that we may help to share your love, share your peace, share your mercy, share your forgiveness with this whole world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us too, God, as we pray for those who know illness in their body, in their mind, in their spirit. Today we pray for families who deal today with the realities of COVID-19. We pray for members of our own church whose lives have been impacted by struggle in body or in spirit. Today we pray for Cindy, Jim and Marlene, for Bob and Karen, for Velma and Rick, Fern, Bob, Marlene, and Bee, and all others who we name before you now. You are our hope. You are our healer, and we place all who we love and all that we have into your care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, remember before you today all who know grief. Hear us as we pray that you would wipe away every tear, that you would give us comfort and help us to remember that we have a home that is prepared, that it is ready for all who love you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, revealed in your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray as one people. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And as we go out to serve the Lord, we sing, "To Be Your Presence." And we talk about in the song the mission of being God's presence to the world. So if you would please join me in singing, "To Be Your Presence." Yep, those mittens and gloves, there's a spot on your way out if you've got any to turn in. Have a wonderful day, everybody.
marching in. Oh, and the saints.